So the fuel system on my MG is an area of the car that I'm not quite happy with. The car has only covered 2,500 miles in the last 15 years, and I suspect all the fuel pipes that are on it are nearly 30 years old, going back to the restoration. I've got this really nice old 1974 Haynes manual, and it's got some quite good illustrations of how the fuel system should be, and it's mostly as pictured on my car. Starting with the fuel pump at the back end, the copper pipe that runs all the way under the car, and there's then a soldered union, a hose with a union nut and pipe nipple on the end of it, going through to a T-piece, short connector to the first carburetor, and then a longer hose between the T-piece and the front carburetor. There's a nice illustration of it there. So my car is pretty much the same, but as with many, in that gap there is another hose and a fuel filter. And I don't really like the situation of the fuel filter, as I'll show you and explain in a minute. There's other pictures of this setup further in the book, and this pipe seems to stop further across the bulkhead on my car, hence this pipe then stops short of reaching the carburetor. So I have a feeling that these copper pipes may be a pattern part. Maybe they've been available for a long time, but made a little too short to accommodate the fact that a lot of people like to incorporate a filter. You see them on just about every car. As you've seen, my car has the plastic element filter that I rather dislike, and one type of filter I do like is these old AC Delco type with the glass bowl. They're quite good for being able to see what's going on in the fuel system. You know, if this is full or if it's half empty, you know, it's a good indicator of what's going on. But they are quite good at separating out dirt. Now, you can actually get a little element that goes inside these, or you can rely on the gauze in the top. I'm quite happy with the gauze. I run the same setup on the Land Rover, and it's generally quite effective. Obviously, the fuel pump on the Land Rover has a built-in filter unit on one side. Two jobs going on here at once, and they kind of tie in quite nicely. So you'll see some video on that as well another time. Anyway, so I've bought one of these cheap knockoff Delco style filters. The originals are really quite expensive. But I have plenty of old Land Rover fuel pump spares, so I've been able to replace the nasty modern plastic clamp with an old one, which obviously I'll clean up, and an AC marked fuel bowl. And it's all slightly nicer stuff than the bits you get on a new one. I mean, plastic in the engine bay, it's not going to last that long, is it? I just don't like stuff like that. So, nice original parts wherever possible. The difficulty with fitting this is that I don't want to drill holes in the bulkhead of the car and where it actually wants to sit, where there is clearance for it. It would kind of sit a bit funny. There's a join on the bulkhead, and as we'll see, it's not, it wouldn't quite work. But more to the point, I want to use existing bolt holes. So to that end, I've made up this little bracket, which started out as a bit of CAD cardboard aided design, and progressed to a drawing, and finally a nice little bracket with some riveted on captives. And it works rather well. There's a quarter UNF bolt for the bonnet hinge that this picks up on, and then there's a 2BA tapping on the bulkhead. So using those two and probably a couple of spaces behind, we can get this to sit nicely on the bulkhead. The filter will sit nicely on there. So the next thing is to make up some pipe work. Now, I've already started on this. I'm fairly happy with this one, and I'm just going to be using these unions and I think they're a UNF thread, and brass olives. Now I've actually soldered these on. Obviously if you do that, the trick is to leave that pipe slightly short of where it stops so that the olive can still compress, and only feed a bit of solder in from one end. That just gives a bit of added security. The pipe, even if that union should crack, the pipe can't pull right out, which can potentially happen otherwise. I think the fuel system is worth a bit of extra care. I've also put a little flare on the end of the pipe, just so that the fuel hose really can't pull off of there. So I've got some more copper pipe, and the next thing to do is to make the pipe that feeds the carburetor. So with the fuel line stripped out of the way, it's a lot easier to get at everything. I'll attach the bracket to the bulkhead of the car, and you can just see I've picked up on a 2BA captive in the bulkhead and one of the bonnet hinge bolts, which obviously isn't wound in yet. Anyway, as you can see, I'm going to need some spacers just to bring the bracket away from this seam here, but I just wanted to get it in place and make sure that the bonnet hinge clears it, which it should do, and check the leg for that pipe. Just room to get underneath and get to the lock nut as well, so it should work nicely. So this is the final fuel filter install. I changed all the fuel pipes yesterday, all new parts from Moss, and actually really good quality fuel hose, so it seems. Very happy with that. So the only extra bit is that bit there, which is the link. I did consider running a copper pipe all the way and then remaking that T-piece or sweating a new piece of pipe into there, but I decided it needs that flexible hose there to protect the fuel pipe and filter from the movement of the engine on the mounts. Anyway, it's gone quite well. I've added some rubber pads behind of just the right thickness, so that's resting against the bulkhead, and then there's spacers keeping it clear of this seam here. Yeah, I couldn't be happier with how that's worked out. There's just room to get underneath and undo the bracket and remove that. Replacing the Gauze filter would probably be a fiddle, but it's actually quite easy once these unions are undone to remove the whole thing. So yeah, it's worked out well. So while we're on the subject of the fuel system, I've just a few days ago had the fuel filler neck out and had a look in the tank, which is really clean in there, no rust, but there was a terrific smell of fuel in the cabin, quite a heavy smell of fuel, and really not pleasant. So to start with, I've cleaned all this tube and I've tightened up the Jubilee clips, and the smell's now gone. The other issue here was water ingress into the car after a night of heavy rain, or even light rain, just washing the car as well. It would be like inch deep in the back there, and the water was tracking under this seal. So I got a new one of those, and I've stuck it to the body with Tiger Seal, which I'm sure I'll regret at some point. But yeah, it's totally waterproof now, so I'm very pleased with that. There's another job done recently. I think I commented in the first video that there were a load of washes under the ignition switch. I was talking about fuel system here, but anyway, just thought I'd give you a little general update as well. So I've taken those washes out now and found a proper lock nut for the ignition barrel. So that all looks as it should. Another issue was I couldn't get in the glove box, but there was a spare key on the bunch that didn't do anything. So I found out how to get the glove box off, removed the hinge, and there was a fault with the lock, but I managed to repair that. So I've now got a functioning glove box, which is great. This car, very sensibly, has been converted to a single battery. So the fuel pump now resides in the offside battery well. Now, some previous owner, I guess the guy that restored the car, boxed in the battery cages. These are normally open to the elements, I believe. And I thoroughly approve of the modification. So the fuel pump isn't in its standard position. Normally they're tucked up behind the offside rear wheel and quite exposed to dirt and so on. Now I'm going to replace this pump because the car has done so little mileage in quite a long time, and I suspect the pump has been in here at least since the 90s when the car is restored. The fuel lines on it at least look quite new, so that's some hope, but I suspect the pump has never been overhauled in all that time. I believe it's the original points type, and I've actually got an electronic one, so I think we'll go and have a look at that. So just rounding up for tonight, this is the new fuel pump, and this is an electronic version of the old SU fuel pump, brand new from Berlin Fuel Systems. They have a little tag on them these days to say what they are, and this one's obviously negative earth to suit my car because of the black band. I think the positive ones have a red band around them, so that just seemed like a sensible purchase to me, just to try and keep the car reliable. It does have some of the symptoms of a variable fuel supply. I think sometimes it's flooding, and then other times it feels like it's running too lean. So you're going up a hill, you get just a slight hint of fuel starvation. Another one is a fast bit of road I drive quite regularly, coming home from work. And I can arrive at the T-junction at the end of it, coast to a halt, and the engine is just spluttering for a moment. And then it picks up. It's a bit like the fuel system just has to catch up. So I'm convinced the pump's in there isn't doing what it should, and I think replacing it with one of these is a very good place to start. One difference nowadays, you might just be able to see the rubber o-ring in there. Apparently the old ones don't have that, and they just rely on fibre or copper washers. So I'm a bit concerned about how long that's going to last. And it may be, if I can't get it all to tighten up nicely, as I know some people have had trouble with, I might, before it's all full of fuel, plug up the holes, put it on the mill, and just flash it across so that I can use some copper washers on it. So anticipating trouble there, but otherwise it looks a very nice thing. So that's going to be a job for another day. So I've now changed the fuel pump on the MGB. I've fitted the new SU electronic pump from Berlin. The pump that was on there, it seems, was an electronic pump, but obviously very old, made by Auto Pumps New Zealand. I've never seen one of those before. I did think, it did occur to me, that I might just see if they were ever available in the UK, because my car is so incredibly rust-free. I do just wonder if it ended up abroad somewhere. Anyway, I will search that one this evening. This pump is a kind of a lesson in being careful with silicon sealants and so on. Someone has at some time had it apart and resealed it with, you know, your usual like clear silicon sealer, and it's all oozed into the inside, and it's obviously affected by fuel. So I'm sure there's been bits of that floating around the fuel system. So we'll clean all that out. Otherwise, there wasn't a lot wrong with the pump, but it is now abundantly clear why I was getting a fuel smell in the cabin. And I could see underneath it had been weeping quite badly. A, from around this joint here, and B, from where the cover goes here. And that was because of a badly split cork gasket. So I'll make a new one of those. So yeah, I think it was a worthwhile operation. Actually fitting the new pump, not difficult at all. Someone has moved the pump inside my car, as you've seen, I think. So I'll throw in a couple of pictures from the install, But yeah, nothing very exciting to say about that. We see how the new seal's lost in the top. I've taken some measurements of the O-ring, so I will get some spares to keep in the car. But yeah, so we'll throw this back together tonight with some new seals in it and keep it as a spare. So this is, I'm going to wind up this video for now, and I think the next one will be a carburetor overhaul. I've got some overhaul kits on the way, and I think we'll most likely be doing the spindle bushes on the SUs. So I'll try and take some film of the machine work involved in that. Well, one final job this evening. I've got this battery isolator to install on the inside of the car. And the idea is to have it poking through from the front of the battery box into the rear footwell of the car on the near side. I can reach it easily from the driver's seat then. I don't really want to drill holes in the bodywork of the car, but it's a safety thing, so I think it's justifiable. And basically that's what you'll see poking through the carpet on the inside of the car. So that's the point of this finisher, to hold the carpet down so it looks tidy and affix the isolator to the inside of the battery box. So when my big terminal crimper arrives, we'll fit that. And there's an auxiliary socket for my sat nav to go alongside it as well. The main thing is to hide all this stuff up the back and not drill any holes in the dashboard or anything like that. So that really is it. I hope you've enjoyed the video, and I will update you again soon. Thanks for watching.